So now that we have determined the SELCs, now let's look at atomic orbitals of central atom, which is beryllium here, right? So the central atom has valence shell as 2s2 and 2p0, right? Okay, so now what is the symmetry for 2s? So 2s under d infinity h point group, we see that the 2s orbital, it's a spherically symmetric orbital, so it must form the basis for sigma g plus. That is the totally symmetric representation. Right? And 2p orbitals, let's say 2px, 2py orbitals, they form the basis of pi u as the pi u IR representation. Right? And 2pz forms the basis for sigma u plus IR representation. So now that you have the symmetry of SELCs and symmetry of the central atom, so you know that which orbitals will combine with what orbitals and which will remain as non-bonding. So these will remain as non-bonding, the px and py. 2s will combine with phi g, 2pz will combine with phi u. All right. So thus we can say, thus we have, let's write down sigma g as C1 times phi g, which is the SALC coming from the two hydrogens. This will combine with C2 2s. Okay. This is the SALC and this is the atomic orbital. Okay. Also, sigma g star can be written as C3 2s minus C4 phi g. Okay. So again, this is atomic orbital and the SALC. All right. So this will form, because summation will give you bonding and this will give you anti-bonding. Now C1, C2, C3, C4 reflect the extent of interaction. We can write down C1, C2, C3, C4 gives you the extent of interaction between respective orbitals. How strongly the overlap, they are overlapping and all. Okay. So similarly, the interaction between 2pz and phi u will give you sigma u, which is equal to C5 2pz plus C6 phi u. This will give you bonding. And sigma u star will give you C7 2pz minus C8 phi. Okay. Now let us try to draw it pictorially and see how, if we get a picture clear. So we can say, so we have our, let's start with sigma g. So sigma g has a 2s orbital, which is the central atom. Let's draw the phase also. So start with positive phase, and then you have plus 1s plus 1s. So remember that we had, if you see here, phi g is positively phased and 2s is also positively phased. Okay. So this plus sign means that the phase is positive. The negative sign means the phase is inverted. All right. So now this is the combination. So this particularly gives rise to orbital, which is something like this. Okay. Actually, this is, we should not write sigma g here. We should write sigma g on this side, because this is the MO. These are the individual atomic orbitals. So you see, directly atomic orbital combination is used. There is no hybridization happening here. So we will write all of them with positive phases. This is the combined MO. So we can write atomic orbitals, and this is the molecular orbital. Okay, the next one was sigma G star, where we had this as positive and phi U, this is negative and this is negative. Not phi U, sorry, we had phi G with negative sign. So here phi G is what? Phi G was 1sA plus 1sB. So both of them have to have same signs, but we have overall phi G negative. So both the 1sA and 1sB go negative here, right? So we'll write 1sA and 1sB. So both of them will go negative. And what is the result here? The result is there is a node formation. So this node represents that there is no electron density here. So this is plus, minus, this is sigma G star. All right. Now for sigma U, what did we have? So we had 2pz with positive phase and phi U. Phi U was, what was phi U? So phi, we will write down here. So phi U was 1 over root 2 1sA minus 1sB. So that means the two s orbitals were with opposite phase in phi U. Okay. So let's write down. So you have 2pz with positive and negative, and 1s was, A was positive and B was negative. Okay. So how does it look? So you have buildup of electron density, or buildup of the wave function here, and buildup of the wave function here in the negative phase. So both the lobes will increase in size. Both the lobes of PZ will increase in size. So this is 2PZ now. And this is 1SA. This is 1SB. Right. So you'll have something like this. Okay, so you have positive enhancement and negative enhancement also will give rise to increase in lobe. So this will give rise to bonding. And there is one node which was originally present in 2pz. So there is no electron density here. All right. So now next one is sigma U star. So sigma U star, if you see that 2pz remains same, and then there is a negative sign for phi U. That means these two will go opposite in sign. Okay. Let's see how it works. So you have plus and minus. Now this side the negative will come, and this side positive will come. Okay. Now again there is a negative phase of wave matching with positive phase. So that means there would be a node formation here, node formation here. So that means there will be total four lobes present. Right. This is, now this is plus, minus, plus, minus, plus, and there are three nodes present, sigma U star. Okay. Now how do we arrange these in terms of energy? So there are, we have got four orbitals, four molecular orbitals. Two of them are bonding, two of them are antibonding. And then we will also have some non-bonding coming from 2px and 2py. So let's see how do we arrange these. So MO theory beautifully describes the relative energy of these orbitals. So there are empirical rules. So we'll write down those rules, a few empirical rules. So again, remember that for explicit energy calculation, you have to resort to quantum mechanical calculations, you cannot calculate explicit energies here. You can only tell about relative energies. A few empirical rules that suggest relative energies of molecular orbitals. Okay, so first rule is that bonding MOs always lie lower in energy than the anti-bonding MO. So that means sigma G will be stable as compared to sigma G star, sigma U will be stable as compared to sigma U star. Okay, so that is one. So you can already see that advantage of delocalized MO theory over localized MO theory or valence bond theory, where we can explicitly write down the relative energies. So non-bonding MOs tend to lie in between bonding and anti-bonding, because non-bonding is not taking part in these kind of bond formation, so they tend to remain where they were for the individual atom. Okay, so there is, in some cases there is interaction with the outer atoms and they tend to destabilize or stabilize in certain cases, but typically they tend to lie between bonding and anti-bonding. There is no change. Okay, so third is pi interaction tends to have less overlap, less effective overlap, we can say, than the sigma interaction. So if the interaction is less effective, that means the stabilization energy will also be less. So that would mean that pi bonding MO have higher energies than sigma bonding MO, even though if they are formed from same atomic orbitals. So fourth point is that pi star MO tend to have lower energy than sigma star MO. See, if the stabilization energy is less, the destabilization energy is also less. So if, let's say, if two atomic orbitals, atomic orbital 1 and 2, are giving rise to a sigma orbital and a sigma star, the stabilization is more as compared to if the same thing will give rise to pi bonding versus pi star. Okay, so that's what I mean here, that the sigma, even though they are forming from the same atomic orbitals, if it is a sigma interaction, the stabilization and the destabilization of antibonding both will be higher as compared to pi interaction because of less effective overlap. Because pi orbitals overlap in sideways, whereas sigma orbitals overlap in head to head, right? Okay, so fifth is molecular orbital energies tend to rise as the number of nodes increase. Sixth is among sigma bonding MOs, those belonging to totally symmetric representation tend to lie lowest. So these empirical rules would define the relative energy. So let us see the case of BeH2. We have already developed the MO diagram. So let's see how the, so we have already developed the molecular orbitals. Let us see how they are arranged in a MO diagram now. So we have for beryllium, we have 2s, which is filled, and then we have 2px, 2py, 2pz, where 2px and y are of different symmetry than 2pz, right? And then for hydrogens, we had SALCs. So we have hydrogen SALCs as phi g and phi u, right? So we get two hydrogens each with one electron. All right, so now we have seen that the s orbital will combine with phi g, so this will give rise to, and then you can also say that you have on beryllium you also have 1s orbital with two filled electrons, which will also be of sigma g plus, but the depending on which will have better energy, which compares in energy to phi g, the combination will take place. So this will typically remain as non-bonding. So you have sigma g plus. This is now for BeH2 molecule. This is Be. Now this will combine with phi g to give rise to sigma g, right? And then this will also give rise to sigma g star. Now 2pz will combine with phi u because of same symmetry again. So this will give rise to sigma u, and sigma u star. So now you see that I have arranged sigma g at the lowest with sigma u, with sigma g star and sigma u star. Okay, this is in increasing energy. Why did I do that? Because if you remember that the number of nodes, if I write here, number of, so first of all, these are bonding, these are anti-bonding, so as per rules they have to be lower in energy as compared to this. So now number of nodes present will dictate which one will be more stable as compared to, whether sigma g is more stable or sigma u is more stable. So sigma g has 0 nodes, sigma u has 1 node, 2 node, 3 node, right? So let me see if I am writing it correctly. Yeah, here. So sigma g has 0 nodes, sigma u has 1 node, sigma g star has 2 nodes, sigma u star has 3 nodes, right? So number of nodes will also define the energy. So that's how they are arranged now: sigma g, sigma u, sigma g star, sigma u star. So there should not be any confusion now. We will see more examples if time permits, we'll discuss. Otherwise, I would suggest you to take home assignment and do it for CH4. Try to develop the MO diagram. We have already done it for valence bond treatment, so it should not be a problem. And take more molecules, take H2O, NH3, and try to develop this MO diagram for all of this and see if you get any difficulty. Of course, we can discuss once you have the difficulty. All right, that is all for today. Thank you.